Tanzania, the discriminating hunter can still find untouched wilderness where he can seek the ultimate hunting experience. Tanzania covers no less than 362,000 square miles, the equivalent of one-tenth of the USA. The country has vast areas reserved for conserving nature and the game living there. Before World War II, a safari in East Africa was synonymous with a hunt in Masailand. No part of Africa contained more game and beautiful country. This is still so, albeit to a lesser extent. Although a large part of the Masai has been turned into farmland, there are still some areas where it's possible to have an extraordinary hunting experience in these beautiful surroundings. The number of different species and the density of game here is not surpassed in many places in Africa. Masailand offers big game hunting in combination with some of the more glamorous species of antelopes, which attract hunters from all over the world. Here they can enjoy a classical safari with its more primitive elements combined with the highest degree of luxury. The authorities strictly control the hunting safaris. This ensures a sustainable use of the game and a significant income in foreign currency. In order to keep up employment in the industry, hunters have to pay for a minimum of 21 days of hunting if the most sought-after trophies are to be taken. Since Kenya closed down hunting in 1976, Ethiopia and Masailand are the only remaining places where it's still possible to hunt such beautiful species as the lesser kudu, the Gerenuk or Waller's gazelle, and the fringe-eared oryx. In spite of the rapid growth of the population in Tanzania, Masailand is still one of the prime game areas of East Africa. In addition to the many species of antelopes, there are also the big four: elephant, buffalo, lion and leopard. Masailand is the home of the biggest and most massive Cape buffaloes in Africa, both when it comes to body and trophy size. Masailand covers a vast part of East Africa, more than 50,000 square miles, about the equivalent of England. The Masai area stretches from central Kenya in the north to central Tanzania in the south. The area is the home of the Masai tribe, hence the name Masailand. Although a number of other tribes inhabit the area, the Masai are the most famous due to their former dominant position as a warrior nation. Formerly, Kenya was the mecca of big game hunting, and almost all safaris began here. Due to political circumstances, however, Kenya chose to close down all big game hunting in 1976, and accordingly we will concentrate on the southern part of Masailand in the following documentary. Towards the northeast lies the Serengeti Plain with its unique ecosystem. To the west we find the Rift Valley, and the Masai Steppe is situated towards the south. The Masai steppe consists mainly of a semi-arid ecosystem with acacias and different species of thornbush. Small forests interchange with grass-covered areas between the characteristic kopjes, which are small rocks of volcanic origin. Precipitation is unevenly distributed and it never rains outside the rainy season. The most well-known part of the Serengeti ecosystem is undoubtedly Masailand. This part of the area covers approximately 12,000 square miles and contains the Masai Mara Game Reserve in Kenya and the conservation area around the Ngorongoro crater in Tanzania. The Ngorongoro crater is one of Africa's most famous attractions. The huge volcanic crater was not discovered by Europeans until late in the 19th century and is now one of the world's most densely populated game reserves. The walls of the crater are more than 2,300 feet high and the bottom is more than 12 miles in diameter. A visit to the Ngorongoro crater is a memory for life. We're heading north for Lake Natron, where we are going to hunt with the Wengert Windrose Safari Company. They have set up the main headquarters in Arusha and run all their safari camps in the northern part of the Rift Valley area, which borders Kenya. Towards the south lie the Mtowa Mbu, Burko Maduli Ju areas, and towards the east lie Longido and Ngasarai, which all have some splendid experiences to offer the visiting hunter. All these areas have approximately the same biosphere, dry and open savanna with thornbush in the valleys and mapani forest on the hillsides. And like no other hunting area, the Lake Natron controlled game area is famous for its unspoiled terrain and vast number of game animals. You might not find buffalo, lion and elephant in the same numbers as on the Serengeti Plain, but in return you'll enjoy the sight of much rarer species like the lesser kudu, gerenuk or the fringe-eared oryx, which are all species especially adapted to living in this rough and arid environment. Weighing only around 65 pounds, Thompson's gazelle is the smallest member of this family of antelopes in East Africa. Unlike other gazelles, Thompsons migrate during the dry season in search of water and grazing, but can live through the dry season without drinking. In Tanzania, its distribution is limited to the northern part of Masailand, where it's found in the areas bordering the Rift Valley. But on the Serengeti Plain, there are more than 500,000 Thompson's gazelle. The beautiful horns of a Thompson's gazelle are a much sought-after trophy, and at present it can only be hunted in Tanzania. Another antelope which is only found in Masailand is Grant's gazelle. The largest of the subspecies is the southern Grant's gazelle, which lives in the Lake Natron area. Another subspecies is Robert's gazelle, which is found on the Serengeti Plain. Body-wise, there are no significant differences between the two species. The southern Grant's gazelle has longer and heavier horns, which are straighter towards the tips and point upwards or forwards, but never towards the sides or backwards, like the horns of Robert's gazelle. However, the most certain indication of the species concerned is its provenance, as the slopes of the Rift Valley separate them. Professional hunter Nick Pretorius from Zimbabwe is working for Wengert Windrose Safaris. Together with his client Gavis from Germany, he's just spotted a small herd of southern Grant's gazelle. The herd consists only of males without territory, and there is a good one amongst them. It's not at all an easy task to get into position, where the big male is not obscured by other gazelles. Nick makes sure that the wind is good. With so many males close to each other, it becomes difficult to make sure that the client is aiming at the right one. The tall vegetation makes it even more difficult to get a clean line of fire. The hunters must be patient and wait for a good chance to make a good shot.
But it's far. How many yards?
Their patience is rewarded. The gazelle drops dead from a perfectly placed bullet from Gerber's 300 Winchester Magnum made by Steyr Mannlicher. Gerber's first head of game taken in Africa.
That's a good one, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Very nice.
The trophy is admired. But Nick was very happy with Gerver's shooting.
Four years around
no more?
Mm. Well,
congratulations.
Notice the base of the horns and that the tips point upwards. The shape is the most typical for the southern Grant's gazelle. The game on the Maasai steppe is the same as that close to the Rift Valley, but lesser kudu, gerenuk, Thompson's and Grant's gazelles are not so numerous. But there are Cape buffalo, elephant, lion, Cook's hartebeest and even greater kudu in much greater numbers. There are no less than 15 hunting zones in and around the Maasai steppe. The northwestern part of the Maasai steppe is a vital part of the biosphere around the Tarangire National Park. In between the two rainy seasons, species such as elephant, zebra, wildebeest, eland and Thompson's gazelle migrate between the good grazing areas on the steppe and the national park, with its permanent source of water, the River Tarangire. During these migrations, the areas around the Tarangire National Park offer some of the best buffalo hunting in Africa. Most of the areas are not game reserves as such, but so-called game-controlled areas. This means that the areas are utilized for more than just game conservation. Agriculture is accepted in these areas, and more of the steppe is being turned into farmland. This constitutes an increasing threat to the wildlife, which is totally dependent on being able to migrate freely. The vast numbers of game animals do a lot of damage to the crops, and predators like lion and leopard take their toll of the domestic stock. The conflict between man and game will inevitably increase during the years to come, as the population of Tanzania is increasing rapidly. At present, the population doubles every 20 years. One way to make room for man as well as game might be to manage the game populations as a sustainable resource instead of domestic stock like goats and cattle. The game is much better at utilizing the land, and income can be generated from both hunting tourism as well as controlled harvest of the annual growth of the different game populations. We return to the area near Lake Natron. Wingard Windrose has arranged a safari for Dane Bobby Jacobson, led by the professional hunter Rainer Josh. The hunters have come to test their skills against two of the most coveted antelopes in East Africa, the tiny Dik Dik and the beautiful Lesser Kudu. The Lesser Kudu is not numerous anywhere in East Africa, but Kirk's Dik Dik inhabits almost every dried-out riverbed, or donga as they are called here. Kirk's Dik Dik is the smallest of the so-called dwarf antelopes in Tanzania. The animals live in pairs and are rarely far apart. The females are normally slightly larger than the males. Their body weight is around 10 to 11 pounds. Only the males carry horns. But the animal's characteristic tuft of hair on top of the head can sometimes make it difficult to distinguish between the two sexes.
But don't mix them up.
As with most other types of hunting, it's necessary to be patient and take the time needed. Quite often it's the female which is the more attentive of the two, and accordingly is the first one to move away, followed closely by the male.
He's a good one. Make sure he stands broadside. It's a very small target. Don't shoot. Wait. Make sure he stands broadside. Just wait. They will come. That's a female. Just drop in his broadside.
He's done,
right,
man.
Yeah, so it's shot. Be careful.
Superb.
Yeah, he's dead. He's stone dead. Great.
Let's go. Have a look.
They're so tiny, I tell you. I hope he has horns.
Oh, I hope too.
They're so small, you know. Don't worry, he has horns. But you never know how big they are.
Yeah. That is good.
The female, yeah. Now the female is running off.
Yeah.
I always stick around. Ein bisschen Licht. Muss mehr.
Yep. He's just so tiny, small.
Yeah.
Animals.
See this here?
Yeah.
The males have that, the females don't have that. The females just have one string in the center.
Yeah.
So you can, when you see this in the center, and no horns, just this here, then it's, you know, it's a female. Sometimes these hair can be so long that they cover the entire hair, the entire horns.
Yeah.
And then it's really difficult, you know, to judge the trophy really.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's just fun, you know.
Yeah.
And it's actually very good meat. It's good eating,
yeah.
We're going to enjoy this one.
Great.
Yeah, it's very nice.
Snapshots for the album back home. Game scouts are members of every hunting safari in Tanzania. They're employed by the government to ensure that the hunting regulations are followed in every respect. A detailed protocol is kept containing information on every shot fired, which species the hunters shot at, and the animals taken. Before the safari commences, every hunter must have a license which specifies which animals can be hunted. Every time an animal is taken, its name is added to the license. At the end of the safari, the client pays the trophy fees, and only then can the trophies be exported. The hunters normally have their lunch in the bush unless they're very close to camp. The cars carry all the necessary items to enable the hunters to have a delicious meal in the bush, although there is naturally a limit to the amount of chairs and equipment that can be brought along. Gervas and Nick are having a well-earned lunch break. After lunch and a short nap, Nick and Gervas try their luck with the small dik-dik antelopes. But it's far from easy to shoot a dik-dik. The difficulty of this appears from the following scenes. A miss. The hunter shot over the animal.
Now he's going to the left.
Too high and behind. It's no easy task to shoot the light-footed dik-dik.
Crazy one. You see him, he's looking at you. Now he will see his head.
Looking to the right?
Yeah.
In the end, however, the dik-dik is killed on the spot.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Nick.
The dik-dik has an elongated upper lip, which resembles a little trunk. This enables the antelope to cool its blood by panting through its nose during periods of extreme heat in the dry season. In order not to blow the minor species apart with his relatively powerful 300 Winchester Magnum, the hunter is using 200 grain trophy extreme penetration bullets, which are also among the best for the larger antelopes.
It was a good hunt, gentlemen. I say thank you.
What are you doing there?
I need new ammunition.
He needs to reload.
Yes.
Why that?
Why that? You know why. I need a lot of rounds.
Gervas had to use three shots in order to take his dik-dik, and the other hunters are teasing him a little. But most of us have had to use more than one cartridge to down ahead of game. The third species of gazelle in Tanzania, beside the Thompson's and Grant's gazelles, is the elegant Gerenuk. It's also called the giraffe gazelle due to its long neck. This extraordinary-looking antelope is never found in the open grassland or tall forest. The Gerenuk lives in the bush, where the dry land excludes competition from other species, which are more dependent on water. The area around Lake Natron is an ideal biosphere for these animals. The Gerenuk does not eat grass, but is a browser. Its ability to stand erect on its hind legs enables it to eat shoots, leaves, flowers and fruits of thorn bushes that are up to 7 feet tall. The Gerenuk never drinks, but gets the necessary water from the leaves it eats during the 8-month-long dry period. The giraffe, which we all know has the same menu as the Gerenuk. The only difference is that the giraffe's food is located a little higher. Although a giraffe is an impressive sight, no animal in Africa is as gracious as the nimble Gerenuk. The first European to describe the Gerenuk scientifically was called Waller. In accordance with tradition, the Gerenuk was first named Waller's gazelle. But nowadays we use the Somali name Gerenuk, which means giraffe-necked. The animals are not very gregarious. Normally you will see Gerenuks in pairs, or at the most in small herds of 6 to 7 animals. A male Gerenuk measures around 40 inches over the shoulder and weighs up to 110 pounds. A good trophy measures 14 inches. Even the ostrich can be found in this area, which quite rightly could be called the home of the long-necked. We shall now follow Bobby and Reiner on a hunt for the Gerenuk. It's not an easy task to get near the alert gazelle, which has very keen sight combined with a good view due to its height. The old male apparently detects the two hunters and drifts away. But as the wind is in their favour, the antelope is not really frightened, and the hunters succeed in getting into a good shooting position.
There he is. Take your time. He's pretty calm. Right there. Right there in the light. Okay, go for it.
The bullet hits the Gerenuk in the shoulder and kills it instantly.
You see that, man? That's the one, man. That's exactly the one we saw last year, you know that? And we've been all the time talking about this. I think that's the one.
Superb, man.
There's a female.
Yeah. There's another one.
Yeah.
So there are two or three of them.
Yes, he was with two females last year. Man, what a beautiful man. Oh, that's very big, yes. Very nice.
Oh, man.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Look at him, Bob.
Man, it's beautiful, huh? We just felt it, huh? We just felt something's going to happen today. This afternoon. Mzuri sana. Yeah, miakajana wana.
You know the two females?
Yeah.
And the small one must be a calf from this year or something.
Yeah.
It's the same male. We're just talking all the time. We're talking about this.
Isn't it? That's Kubo-san,
yeah.
This is 15, man. It must be 15 inches.
Yeah.
I think he's more than 15. He's fantastic.
In addition to the exciting hunt, the hunters get a bonus. The horns are no less than 16 inches long. A very good trophy.
Well, there are plenty around, but there are not many that big.
It's quite rare to see owls during the daytime. But here is a big species called the rose eagle owl. After the success with the Gerenuk, Bobby and Reiner are trying to find a lesser kudu. The lesser kudu is a very shy animal. Should it detect the hunters, it will always move into dense vegetation and hereby always, always notice the hunter before he can get into a shooting position, no matter how good a tracker he is. Accordingly, the hunters decide to find a place with a good view and wait for an animal to start feeding in the open. This technique normally gives the best chance to observe the animals while they are undisturbed. The strategy proved successful.
Someone there.
Okay. Down here.
No, not the two green the trees. The next one, the big one, right underneath there. You wait. We'll see him.
Yeah.
blessing him. Where is he now? He's just down there. He's just down there.
There are many reasons why the horns of a lesser kudu are among the most prized in the world. Like its bigger cousin, the greater kudu, the adult male has twisted horns, which make 2.5 and sometimes even 3 full turns. The elegant antelope has 11 to 15 vertical white stripes along its bluish-grey skin. Like all the rest of the spiral-horned antelopes, the lesser kudu has whitish areas on its throat, 2 bright spots on each side of its face, and a white chevron across the bridge of its nose. The lesser kudu is always found in areas with acacias, where it seeks the protection of the thorn bush. Although the lesser kudu shares the same biosphere as the Gerenuk, it rarely eats acacia leaves. Scientific research has shown that the lesser kudu feeds on more than 100 different types of plant, mostly leaves, but also shoots, seeds, different kinds of fruit, and young grass.
Can you stay here?
A mature lesser kudu weighs around 220 pounds, while the females rarely weigh more than 150.
You can take mine. It would be better if Labo stays here and see. We will clean the house. The people will call it you new. People are going to have a see, what we have to do is we have to go down and we have to go back in again. And we try to see Labo. Labo, you better stand there. From here you can see him now underneath the tree.
The distance from the hill is too far for a decent shot. Therefore, the hunters decide to walk in a circle around the kudu and stalk him from there. This includes the risk of being spotted, but this is the only chance of a sporting shot. The hunters very carefully approach the spot where the animal was last seen.
The tree behind. Okay. You know what the tree I mean?
This one here again, the little branch.
No, no, what I mean is we, the people, we're walking around. We come where the mbuga is, okay?
Yeah.
And we come to that, open to that tree. We just wait there. And when you see us there, you can tell us. Like, you went this way, or it's some like this.
The hunters are discussing how to get closer. And after having studied the kudu and the terrain very carefully for a while, they decide to try a stalk.
That was in the mountain there.
Yeah.
Can I have your binders?
Yeah.
I had to give mine to Labo.
Okay.
So he can look for the lesser kudu.
Yeah.
Let's go over to that tree.
Yeah.
Just let me have a look.
The stalking is very difficult, and Rainer decides to climb a tree in order to try to get a glimpse of the animal.
He must be still somewhere there.
The kudu must be here somewhere, although Rainer cannot see him. Hopefully he hasn't moved further into the bush.
He's still around. Let's just go. Very careful, very slowly. Just go very slowly.
There. There he is. Lesser kudu has not noticed them at all. This is their big chance. Now the hunters have to stay calm and be ready if the chance of a decent shot should arise in spite of the thick bush.
You see him?
Yes.
You can see the horns. He's facing away from us.
He's looking around now. Shall I take him in the neck?
No, no, wait just a bit.
I can take him now.
Are you comfortable?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, do it.
Okay.
Bobby and Rainer quickly run up to the animal to make sure it's dead.
Whoa, through the neck, man!
Woohoo! Woohoo!
It's a nice one, eh?
That was incredible.
Yeah. Wow! It's a great one, man. What a beautiful asakuru. Well, I was lying about the size, I can tell you that. You shot him right through the neck, man. Unbelievable. That was the only chance. Yeah, it was too much cover.
A most fortunate end to an exciting and very difficult hunt. It can be difficult to keep entirely calm when Lady Luck finally smiles after so many attempts. And the trophy is magnificent, 30 inches.
And he didn't even notice what happened. He didn't know we were there. He was just, and he was completely on his own, huh? No females. Yes, yes!
Jesus,
Bobby is immensely pleased with this fantastic trophy, taken under the most difficult conditions. This is big game hunting at its very best.
That was the only chance I had.
That was a great hunt. You can't beat that hunt. Great. That's a beautiful trophy.
It was great.
It was a great hunt, huh?
Great hunt for a lesser kudu.
For, yeah. Better than a lesser hunt for a greater career.
Yeah.
No, I mean, that's great because, you know, especially on this trophy, I mean, you have to, whenever you see, you have the chance to shoot one, you usually take it, but, you know, we had even a great stalk. It took us about an hour.
Yeah.
From the minute we saw him to when we got him. You see, they all... You can really see that they're all one family, the bush bucks and the elands and the greater kudu, the lesser kudu. They have all the markings in the face. Beautiful. And he's really nice and dark, you know. Sometimes they don't get that dark. That's also a sign of age, but, you know, sometimes they just stay light. But this is going to be a really nice cape. And this, the taxidermist can fit. It's just a cut anyway. Beautiful.
Beautiful horns.
Mm.
Nice, old, mature bull.
Yeah.
We haven't done anything wrong with that one.
No. It was good, you know, he was on his own. We didn't even disturb anybody.
No.
It was a great shot. You see that, Labu? You couldn't see it, huh? Isn't that unbelievable? Look, we shot from right there where you now. I mean, further on. 80 yards. You saw the shooting stick there? Yeah. We shot from there, and he shot him right through the neck because the only thing he could see was the neck.
I don't see him again. When I saw him run, he ran. He only went where...
Did he run?
Yeah, he ran a little bit on this top.
Why did he run? Did he notice something?
Yeah, he noticed. When he climbed up the tree, he lay down.
Oh, he was laying down?
Yeah. When he climbed up the tree, he stand up and he started, he came back like the festival.
Really?
And he started walking slow.
So you thought, ah, oh, that's it, over, huh? Yeah, they will never get him.
And they say, do fast, fast. They're still walking fast. They say, do, I say, what? Walk fast, fast, fast.
Really?
Yeah. And suddenly I don't see again. And I say, I look for this thing, I don't see. Kudu. Uh-huh. I look for you, I don't see. I try to look, I hear the shot.
What are you saying, Labo?
Good.
Isn't that great?
Oh,
we are lucky, huh? Yeah?
Look at the shot.
Right, like from slightly... right through the neck, like slightly from the back, you know?
Yeah.
Angling away, right through here. He went down like a stone.
Yeah, broke.
Oh, it's beautiful, huh?
Yeah.
That's a great trophy. And it's a nice one, huh?
Yeah.
It's a nice trophy. Well, it's an old bull and... It was a perfect hunt, man.
Yeah.
Hunting cannot be more perfect. And all that on a lesser kudu.
Yeah.
Not a pheasant or a roebuck. It's a lesser kudu.
The entire camp staff is happy on Bobby's behalf. The good spirit helps to make a safari a unique experience, and not just a matter of collecting a number of trophies. Hunting the lesser kudu is something very special, A dream has come true for Bobby. Almost all the hunting concessions in the Rift Valley area contain mountains, which are over 9,000 feet. The mountains are remains of volcanic activity in conjunction with the appearance of the Great Rift Valley 20 million years ago. Today, the mountains are covered with forest, which is a perfect biosphere for buffalo, leopard, bushbuck, duiker, and many other species. Jens Henrik Raffen is showing the Maasai his rifle. They are very interested in it, although they are not hunters.
Bushbuck. Buffalo.
The hunters are preparing for an old-fashioned foot safari into the mountains. Not even four-wheel drive vehicles can get there, and accordingly there is a limit to the quantity of luxury items which can be brought along. A fair physical condition is necessary to hunt in these mountains, and frequent breaks give the hunters a chance to catch their breath and enjoy the sight of the many flowers in these extraordinary surroundings. Mount Gilai is situated in the Game Conservancy area close to Lake Natron. Here the hunters have made a base camp at an altitude of 6,000 feet. From here they go on short hunting expeditions into the mountains. If the hunting area is too far away to reach in one day, the porters will carry a fly camp, which includes only the necessary equipment for sleeping and cooking a meal in the field. The African raven is quite common in these mountains. It's somewhat larger than its European cousin and easy to recognize due to the white nape of the neck and the heavier beak. Jens Henrik makes himself comfortable when the hunters reach the site of the fly camp. There are very good hunting opportunities in these mountains, and some hunters return time and again to enjoy the special and challenging safari where everything is done on foot, exactly as it was at the beginning of the 20th century. The hunters leave the fly camp to search for buffalo. They have provisions for 3 days of hunting, and it will be interesting to see if they're lucky here at the top of Mount Gilai. Olaronjo is the Maasai village's elder and an excellent hunter with quite unique eyes. He knows the mountain better than anyone and carries the professional hunter's double rifle with pride. The hunters follow the game paths made by the elephants, as the buffalo use them too. A foot safari like this is quite an outstanding experience. The mountain is also the home of many species of forest-dwelling birds. The sights and sounds of the many birds are a welcome distraction from the quest for buffalo. The hunters see buffalo every day, but several times it proved to be too difficult to get closer due to the terrain, or the buffaloes detected the hunters before they could get a shot. Now the hunters have spotted buffalo again. This time it's two old bulls grazing the slope on the opposite side of the valley. The hunters are trying to see if the buffalo have horns worth a stalk. But even if they do, it will still be a problem to stalk through the heavy vegetation in the valley, as they are bound to lose sight of the animals here. Unfortunately, it's too late in the evening for a good stalk before nightfall. The hunters can only hope that the buffalo are still in the area the next day. Early next morning, the hunters are lucky. At dawn, they see a herd of buffalo on its way to a waterhole nearby. An old bull is leading the herd. The hunters must hurry because the buffalo will not stay in the open for long, but will soon return to the forest. The first buffalo are already leaving the waterhole. Fortunately, they come quite close to the hunters. The bull is the last animal to leave the water. The hunters are perfectly placed for an ambush. Jens Henrik must find cover so the buffalo do not see him.
It's the one who's coming out now.
Yes, yes, that's the one.
There's the bull. The bull drops at the first shot while the rest of the herd runs towards the forest. Jens Henrik instantly reloads his Krieghoff 500-416 Express and the hunters run closer to the spot where the buffalo fell. But suddenly something unexpected happens. Jens Henrik and Rainer are both shocked and relieved after the buffalo's attack. The tracker Harrison congratulates Jens Henrik, and Ola Ronjo also comes back, obviously shocked by the attack. Everybody held their breath during the hectic moments after the first shot.
It's a big buffalo too.
I'm completely...
You would have been still pushing while he was pushing you down the mountain.
He was coming, man.
Yeah, he was coming.
Suddenly...
He was close.
Did you film it?
Yeah, I
he was standing there.
Big bull, man.
Big body, look at the neck.
Unbelievable.
The buffalo very nearly got the cameraman. Earlier on during the safari, Jens Henrik had asked about the risk of a charge, but he never thought it would happen to him.
I do better on distances of 5 meters than on the...
This is buffalo hunting in its most intense form. All again in slow motion. Jens Henrik fires a shot which does not stop the buffalo. The tracker jumps away, and the professional hunter takes action. Big game hunting always involves a certain element of danger. The professional hunters have a saying, The most dangerous buffalo is the one you believe is dead. It goes without saying that the professional hunters do their utmost to avoid bringing their clients into dangerous situations. But under the right circumstances, big game is both aggressive and physically capable of killing the hunter, given the chance to get sufficiently close. Accordingly, there will always be a small risk of something unforeseen happening. This is the reason why it's mandatory to be accompanied by a professional hunter during a safari in Tanzania. Due to its extraordinary production of adrenaline, the buffalo gets back on its feet again and charges the hunters, who have difficulty in getting a good shot in because of the terrain and the vegetation. But when the moment of truth arrives and his professionalism is tested, Reiner kills the buffalo bull less than a yard from the hunter's feet. This is buffalo hunting at its best. The trophies in this area are not spectacular, but the quality and the challenge of the hunt are second to none, although charges admittedly are rare occurrences.
I should thank Krikov and all the workers for making such a not only beautiful gun, but also a gun which really works. This gun really, it kind of saved our life today.
Absolutely.
This second shot on the buffalo, on the charging buffalo, I mean, the first shot was about 6 meters, and with another gun which is not as balanced as this one, I would have never been able to get up the second shot in such a short time. The second shot came out probably at 3 yards. Yeah. I mean, the buffalo dropped instantly on the second shot,
yeah,
because it was brained,
yeah,
and the first shot missed the brain.
A very special end to a most memorable hunt. The experience is perfected by the beautiful hills, the colourful Masai, and the wide plains of the foot of the mountain Oldonyo Lengai, which towers towards the sky on the horizon. This safari was the experience of a lifetime, which neither Reiner nor Jens Henrik will ever forget. Tanzania welcomes you to unique hunting experiences.